What I need you to know about the book of Job tonight is that, like no other book, it's going to talk about the test or the trial. Now, I don't know about any of you, but if you've been a Christian for any length of time, you've been through some tests and you've been through some trials. And I want us to learn some things tonight. You got to understand something, that there's no man that's ever been tested by God, at least that I can see, the way that Job was tested by God. And so there's some various ideas that we need to understand as we go through. Number one, every test is spiritual. And there's a spiritual level to the test that you're going through. And what I want you to understand about that is that under the test, under the spiritual aspect of the test, there's an aspect that God is behind, and typically there's always going to be an aspect that Satan is behind.
Amen.
God allows Satan a certain amount of leeway in the life of the believer in order to accomplish his will. God is the master orchestrator, but he tells the liar how far that he can go. The Word of God teaches us clearly in the book of James that God is not tempted by evil, nor does he tempt any man with evil. God is not the orchestrator or causing you to fall into sin. He didn't purposely plan for you to have sin, but what he did do was he allowed the enemy to have some leeway in your life, but he told him he was only allowed to go so far. And at the same time, God gave you the grace and the strength that you needed in order to bear under the trial and to keep your faith in Christ through the trial so that you can come out victorious. But I didn't come out victorious, preacher. Hey, welcome to the club. How many Christians have failed the Lord, but nevertheless, the Proverb says that a righteous man falls seven times, but he gets back up. Amen? And that's why he says in 1 John that we have an advocate with the Father, that Jesus has shed his blood. So I tell you these things so that no man might sin. But if any man sins, we have an advocate with the Father. Hallelujah. And we are forgiven by the blood of the Lamb of God. Amen? And so what you and I need to understand is that God doesn't waste anything. And many times we think that we have things figured out, but God is allowing things. And what I need you to understand is this, is that in the purpose of every test or trial, God's purpose is that you and I would pass the test, that we would be proven, if you will, and Satan's plan is that you and I would be destroyed. Let there be no mistake, what Satan's desire is that Job would curse God and that he would turn his back on the faith. That's what Satan wants to happen in the midst of this situation. There's a spiritual level in every trial that you and I cannot see with our physical eyes. Nevertheless, the scripture is clear in the book of Ephesians. You war not against flesh and blood. You're not in a war against flesh and blood. The people that you see, the people that you talk to, the people that irritate you, the people that frustrate you, you're not in a war against flesh and blood, but against principalities, powers, world rulers, spiritual wickedness in high places. The enemy of your soul will not only use people out there that hate you, he will also use people that say that they love you. We're going to see that in the story. And the enemy will try to use, and he will bombard you. And the whole time, what you got to understand is this, God's got a purpose. God's got a purpose, and he's putting you to the test. He's allowing your faith to be tested in the midst of every trial and in the midst of every situation. So I want you to know that there's a spiritual aspect that you and I can't see. And then there's the trial itself. And you know, the trial is taking place there's something that's being orchestrated in the heavenly realm, but it's being manifest on earth. And you can pick your, I don't want to say pick your poison, that's maybe not the right word terminology. You can fill in your own blank on what your trial looks like. It can be relationship trials. It can be financial trials. It can be physical health trials. It can be things that, you know, that you're going through. Trials from your past that still try to plague you. You know what I'm saying? There's just various things that you could be going through. Each and every one of us in this place tonight is going through a trial. You can fill in your own blank. But what I'm here to tell you is this, is that the truths that we will find in these scriptures in some way, shape, or form will apply to your life as you go through the midst of the trial. Amen? And so I want you to see that the trial, it's manifest on earth. It's a reality. It takes place on earth and it's a reality. You feel it. You're going to know it when you're in the midst of a trial. Some trials are a whole lot worse than other trials. Some trials are small. They only last for a moment in time, but if it's not handled right, it can turn into a big old mess. You know what I'm talking about? All right. The last thing, really, at least as far as regarding the book of Job,
is that there's people involved. And I know I already told you that you're not in a war against flesh and blood, but I want to point out that much of what's going on in Job's life revolves around people. Okay? And you and I deal with people. Listen, anybody that's worked in the public for any length of time knows good and well that when you got to deal with people, you got to deal with some issues. We are flawed creatures. And don't, listen, the preacher knows he's flawed. You don't think he thinks he's got it figured out, do you? But the reality of it is that people are fallen. And if we're honest with one another, we don't really know how to treat each other. Amen. Even though we're born again and the Holy Spirit, we got new visitors here tonight, and they may say, hey, well, I don't know where you're from, but where we're from, we know how to treat each other. Well, look, I got bad news. People in America, even in the church, they don't know how to treat each other. Amen. We're so selfish in this country. Amen. We think everything revolves around us. The reality of it is that no, it is not all about us. It's all about Jesus, and Jesus is wanting to do a work on the inside of us, and he's wanting to teach us how to handle our business in such a way that it brings him glory. Amen? That's just good preaching. Not because I'm a good preacher, just because that's good preaching. Jesus, the Word of God says that you and I are to be conformed into the image of his dear Son. That means a molding process is taking place. John the Baptist said, I must decrease so that he might increase. The Lord is wanting to mold you and I into the fashion and form of his dear Son so that we will look like him, act like him, respond like him. Amen. What we're going to see in the book of Job is that Job was a whole lot closer to the heart of God than what his friends were. But his friends were so blinded by their own self-religion, their own self-righteousness, and their own quote-unquote wisdom, that they couldn't even see that God wasn't even having a relationship with them. And yet at the same time, you would have sworn that they had all of the answers that humanity needed in order to fix the problems that were plaguing their society of the day. And many times I have to say to you, as I was reading that today, I realized that I've been that way. And I hope it's okay. See, I don't mind. I've learned already that people will turn that kind of stuff around on me, and they'll say, you see, you got this problem because you admit it. Look, whatever, good, bring it on. Yeah, the preacher will use himself as an example. I got all the problems. But at the same time, the Lord's doing a work, amen, and he is going to change. Hallelujah. And if it's easier for me to use myself as an example, then so be it. But just let it be known, I'm pretty perceptive by the grace of God, and I can assure you that you got your own problems too. Amen? And the Lord's wanting to work it out in all of us. Praise God. All right. So the first thing about the spiritual aspect of the story I want you to see is right here in chapter 1 of the book of Job. And it says, there was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job. Now, real quick, we don't really know exactly who Job was. I can tell you that in Genesis chapter 46, there is the name Job is in Genesis 46. And it states that one of Issachar's sons was named Job. Issachar was one of the 12 sons of Jacob. And it says that Issachar had a son named Job. Some commentators would tell you that it's the same Job that we read about, but there's no way to really truly prove that in the scripture. It is likely that the time frame that Job lived was during the patriarchal time frame, meaning the Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the patriarchs, the males that started the whole faith, if you will. That's what the word patriarchal means. During that time frame, they attended livestock, they were wealthy. Amen. And what we're seeing, though, what I do want you to know for sure is that Job is an extremely wealthy man. The Bible goes on to talk about, actually right here, it says in verse 2, and there were born unto him 7 sons and 3 daughters. So he had 10 children. His substance also was 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, and 500 she asses or donkeys. And a very great household, so that this man was the greatest of all the men of the East. So I want you to think about this. He had 500 donkeys. He had 500 yoke of oxen. That means he had 1,000 oxen, because a yoke is a pair. He had 3,000 camels, and he had 7,000 sheep. Do you realize how much property you have to own in order to have this type of livestock?
Do you realize the kind of milk that was being produced from this man's livestock? Well, you get milk from oxen, camels, sheep. I mean, you don't even realize. I mean, these are all mammals. They produce milk. And my point is that we don't realize the substance and the magnitude of the money that this man had, the wealth that he had. And it talks about all the servants. He had a household full of servants. It says in verse 4, let me just kind of tell you the story so that we can move on a little bit. It says in the story that his sons were having a feast. Some people speculate maybe there was a wedding and everybody's getting together and they're feasting and they're playing their music and they're doing their thing, they're eating. And Job's not even really at the feast. What he's doing is he's outside offering up sacrifice. He offers up 10 sacrifices unto God for his 10 children. The reason that Job does that is because he perceives in his heart, or he feels in his heart, there is the possibility that my children right now may not be, I'm going to just paraphrase it, may not be living for God the way that they should. Their hearts may not be right before the Lord. So what I want to do, because I love God, and I want God to protect my house, I want God to protect my children, I want Him to know that even if by some chance my children don't love Him the way that they should, I love Him, and I want to make it aware to Him, okay? And so he offers up these 10 sacrifices based on the fact that there's the possibility that his offspring that he has raised up could be living their lives in such a way that it's not pleasing to the heart of God. And so it says that's what he did. And in verse 6, this is where the antagonist of the story comes in. This is where the enemy of your soul comes in. The enemy of Job's soul comes into the story. And this is the spiritual part that we can't see. You know, I'd like to say something too. You got to understand something. You and I have a luxury. And it's not anybody's fault but your fault or my fault if we don't take ourselves upon this luxury. The luxury we have is we have the story of Job in this Bible. See, Job doesn't have a clue of what's going on. I remember I preached one time something called the test, and I can remember that there's times in Job's, in this story of Job, where he was ready to throw in the towel. He was ready, it seemed like he was ready to quit. He said, I rue the day that I was born. I wish that that day would be taken off the calendar and that they wouldn't remember it anymore. And he was going through great trial, great tribulation, great pain. And he was feeling grief and separation from God. And I can remember my spirit when I was writing that sermon. I was like, no, Job, don't quit, man. We're over here watching. We're like an audience. And we're watching the struggle that's taking place. And God has let us know that there's an enemy of your soul. And he presented himself before God. And he told God that you would turn your back on him. He told God that the only reason that you serve him is because God blessed you. And now the test has begun. Don't quit, Job. Hold on to the Lord. Amen. So Job didn't know all of that was going on. Now, he would have known that there was an adversary of God. He knew about the garden story. That was all told through oral tradition. But he didn't know that Satan personally went up as the accuser before God to tell God that Job didn't really love him and that he only served him for what he could get. Come on, somebody. And so, but you have the luxury to go back and realize that every trial you encounter, everything that you go through, that there's an enemy of your soul, the accuser of the brethren, Revelation chapter 12, the one who goes before the Father and accuses you before God day and night. One day he will be cast down back to the earth. Woe unto the inhabitants of the earth on that day, for he will be full of wrath because he knows that his time is short. But hallelujah, what you and I need to know is this, is that we have the word of God to go back on and to realize, hey, God allowed this. God allowed this thing in my life. And if he allowed it, then that means he has a purpose.
Amen.
Amen. And he's going to get me through.
Amen.
No matter what you're going through, if you'll hold on to the Lord, if you won't quit, he won't quit on you.
Amen.
And if you'll hold on to the Lord, he's going to get you through. Amen.
Amen.
And so it says right here in verse 6, it says, there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan came also among them. Now, we don't have time to really get into the details of this, but the sons of God right here is definitely talking about angels. And whether it's talking about fallen angels or good angels, I don't really want to spend a lot of time on that, but I can tell you in the book of Genesis chapter 6, the same terminology in the Hebrew is used, Ben Elohim, sons of God, and there it's talking about fallen angels. And so, but you know what? The angels are the sons of God in the sense that they are his creation. There's scripture in the New Testament that says that unto all those who believed, he made them to be the sons of God. Human beings that have placed their faith in Christ have become the sons of God, but there was only one Son of God. Amen. The only begotten of the Father. And so anyway, what we see in the spiritual realm, in the heavenly realm, is this situation where Satan and these angels present themselves before God. And what's taking place is that, well, let's just go ahead and read it. He says, "And the Lord said unto Satan, Whence comest thou?" In other words, where you been, Satan? "Then Satan answered the Lord and said, From going to and fro in the earth and from walking up and down in it." Now, I feel like I'm spending a lot of time on this part, but let me just ask you a question. What do you think Satan's doing while he's walking to and fro and up and down in the earth?
Tempting.
He's tempting. He's testing. He's putting people to, he's, you know, doing this, that, and the other thing. And now what do you think he plans on coming to do to God now that he's been down there walking around? See, the Word of God says in 1 Peter 5:8, it says, "Be sober, be vigilant. Your adversary, the devil, roams around like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour." And so he's looking. He's looking for anything and anybody that he can devour. He's looking for anybody that he can put the test on, cause him to fail. And as soon as you fail, and believe me, if you didn't fail in a while, you better hold on. You better not get prideful. You better come to the realization that it's your faith in what Christ has done that is the only thing that's going to give you access to grace and continue to give you strength. And so, because if you haven't failed as a Christian yet, believe me, it will happen. It's going to happen. But when it does, you need to understand that God has a plan. Nevertheless, when you fail, the first thing he does when it's time for him to go back and present himself, he's the accuser of the brethren. And he's saying, "Oh, look at this one. Look at that one. They say they love you, and look at what they did." And what I need you to know is that I know firsthand as a Christian what that feels like. How the enemy and what he does and how he dangles bait in front of our eyes and how he causes us to want to take a hold of it. And then what happens? Rushing in a cloud of condemnation to weigh you down, to make you feel unworthy. The first thing that he does is he makes you feel so unworthy that you don't feel as though you can go back into the presence of God and to ask forgiveness. You feel so unworthy sometimes that you don't even feel like you have the right to ask forgiveness from God. And I'm here to tell you that is a lie from the pit of hell. That's his old tactics. He's been playing the same game for thousands of years of human history. And the truth of the matter is this, that God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son. And all he is one cry away. Call upon the name of Jesus, and you can be restored, amen, into the presence of God. So the enemy comes, and so what God says is this in verse 8. "And the Lord said unto Satan, But have you considered," the word "but's" not there. He says, "Have you considered my servant Job, that there is none like him in the earth, a perfect and an upright man, one that fears God and escheweth evil?" Now, whenever I first started to study the Bible, I was under the impression, and I still have conversations with people who still think this today, that Job was perfect, meaning he never once failed. That's not true. That's not consistent with Scripture. The Scripture says there was only one who had no sin. His name was Jesus. Amen. Job was born as part of Adam's fallen race, just like you were born as part of Adam's fallen race. The Word of God, when it uses the word "perfect," talks about he was a complete man. He was a man in his walk with God. He was a man that desired to serve God. He turned from the evil way. And in that time frame, when there was very little knowledge really about God, he knew one thing. He knew to offer sacrifice unto God. Amen. And that's always been God's plan for forgiveness. And ever since the garden incident, when Adam and Eve fell and they tried to cover themselves with fig leaves, God said no, and he covered them with the skins of an innocent animal. That's all a picture of the cross, and this is the way that we are forgiven and found innocent in the eyes of God, is that through faith in what God's plan would be, through the shedding of blood, we would now receive a position of righteousness, a pronouncement of innocence over our lives. And that's what Job was doing. He didn't understand all that exactly like I'm telling you, because he was so far back in the Old Testament. But what he did know is that God required blood, because it was an oral tradition that had been spoken from the time frame of the garden. It had to be. How else do you think that they wrote it down when it got to the time frame of Moses? Because the Hebrew people that were called by God were passing it on through oral tradition till it was finally pinned upon the paper. And so Job understood that God required sacrifice. So he was a man that was perfect in the eyes of God, in the sense that he desired with all of his heart to serve God. Satan goes on to say in verse 9, he says, Satan answered the Lord and said, does Job fear God for naught? In other words, is there no reason that he does? Have you not made a hedge about him, meaning a fence? Have you not fenced him in and protected him? Look at what you've done for him. Of course he loves you. Of course he's perfect. You built a fence around him. Can't get to him. Why don't you go ahead and remove that fence a little bit and let's see what happens. And that's basically what he's saying. He says, have you not made a hedge about him and about his house and about all that he has on every side? That thou hast blessed the work of his hands and his substance is increased in the land. He says, but put forth thine hand now and touch all that he has, and he will curse you to your face. And so we see in one day, messenger after messenger come back and tell Job that when it's all said and done, between two bands of raiders and fire falling from heaven and a wind that sounds like it becomes tornadic, he loses all of his children and all of that livestock. And all but just a few of his servants in one stroke. All gone. 10 funerals in one day. That fast. And here Job is thinking, I mean, come on, somebody, help me out here. And we know, we've been given the testimony of God. We know how God thinks about Job. God says, have you considered my servant Job? He's an upright man. Amen? He's doing what it is that I've asked him to do. But yet at the same time, in one day, it's all gone. Now, how would you feel if you were Job? I mean, immediately you're going to be shocked. I've never heard of something like this happening to a person that loves God and God loves them. Such tragic circumstances taking place in somebody's life so fast and in one moment of time. And you know, what ends up happening is that the enemy comes back again in chapter 2, verse 1. They came back. I'm not going to read it all, but basically the enemy comes back and he says, okay, because see, Job didn't curse God. And what he said was, he said that one commentator made this comment when the enemy said skin for skin. Like, in other words, Job still loves you because you spared his life. Oh, he's heartbroken because you took his children, but touch his skin and see what happens. Touch him and his body. To remove your hand from him and let me strike. And so in both of these cases, in both of these trials, God allows the enemy, the first time he tells him, you can take what he has, but don't you touch him. And in the second one, he says, you can touch him, but spare his life. And so he strikes him with boils. It was possibly some type of a disease where I read about it, pemphigus something or another. I've never even heard of it, but it the sores had, not only were they like sores like boils, but they had worms in them, and not only that, but they itched. And so not only did they hurt, but they itched, and that's why he took that pottery and he began to scrape that stuff on his body. And so here he is in the midst of this misery, and what ends up happening, this is the first of these people right here. These people that love you. You know what I'm talking about? The people that oftentimes they love you to your face, but then you find out that they don't love you so much behind your back. And then what ends up happening is that whenever you hear about that, if you're going to operate in the flesh, a lot of times what you're going to do is you're not going to act like Job, but instead you're going to act like, you know, something that we're not supposed to act like. But we've got to remember something, that we're being conformed into the image of Christ. Amen? Amen. The true church is going to, we're going to learn humility one way or the other. And if God has to allow trials to take place in our life for us to do that, then the faster we learn the humility and how to submit to God, the faster that this trial can move on to the next one. Amen? And so what happens is, here's the first of the people, verse 9, after he gets stricken with boils, chapter 2, verse 9, then said his wife unto him, dost thou still retain thine integrity? Curse God and die. That's our words of wisdom for Job. You mean to tell me, after we've lost all of our children, all of our livestock, the majority of our servants, and then now God strikes you with worm-infested boils that are itching you so bad that you're grabbing a piece of pottery to scrape your skin off of your flesh, and you're going to continue to retain your integrity, and you refuse to speak bad words about God? You need to curse God and die is what you need to do, Job. And the Word of God says that he wouldn't do it. But now what we see here in verse 11 says, now when Job's three friends heard of all this evil that was come upon him, they came everyone from his own place. And here's the names of them: Eliphaz the Temanite, and Bildad the Shuhite, and Zophar the Naamathite, for they had made an appointment together to come to mourn with him and to comfort him. So that's what they're coming to. We heard our old buddy Job is having a rough time. We're going to go down there and we're going to mourn with him and we're going to comfort him. Now I got to tell you, it's not going to take long to realize that that's not really what's going on. And the more that you really start to at least ponder the story, the more you begin to realize, at least as I was driving home, it kind of hit me. What's the motivation here? I started thinking about Job. I started thinking about the fact that he was so wealthy. I mean, I'm sure there were other wealthy men. As a matter of fact, these men are probably wealthy, but I guarantee I don't think they were as wealthy as Job. And not only that, they had wisdom, but I don't think they had the wisdom of Job. And I started realizing something. These old boys are full of envy, and they have been for a long time. And now Job is on the wrong end of the deal, or at least it appears to be, and they just been waiting for their opportunity to pounce on him like a lion. You see, the truth of the matter is that you never really know what the wickedness that is inside the people's hearts. Amen. And whenever you start seeing people, whenever you're down or you're beat up, you know, and they're trying to help beat you up, there's something wrong with that. I'm here to tell you right now, that is not the heart of God. Amen. The heart of God wants to love people. The heart of God wants to help restore people. It's not that he never brings correction. Come on. But the fact of the matter is that when people are beat down, the Lord wants to help lift them up. Amen. He wants to strengthen them. Amen. Amen. And we see it. We see these things even in the text. But let's see here. Chapter 3. This is, in chapter 3, I'm just going to kind of tell you real quick. Job, this is when Job says, I wish, like in verse 3, let the day perish wherein I was born, and the night in which it was said, there is a man-child conceived. Verse 4, let that day be darkness, let not God regard it from above, neither let the light shine upon it. I'm not going to keep reading, but I want you to see how Job's feeling. He doesn't want to curse God, but he's like, why has this happened to me? I wish I would have never been born. It'd been better had I not been born than I have to be afflicted like this. And this is also the place where he says, I wish they would just take this day out of the year. The day that I was born, it ought to just be removed from the year, as bad as this situation is. But then we have in chapter 4, where Eliphaz the Temanite, and I'm just kind of focused on him mostly, because I mean, all three of them have a discourse with Job on three different occasions, and Job comes back and gives a rebuttal, and we don't have time in this particular, you know, setting to deal with all of that. But I'm just trying to show you and give you a little bit of an idea of what's going on here and how you could possibly equate this to people maybe that even have been in your own life, and how maybe they treated you whenever they thought that you were down. You know what I'm saying? I mean, you know, it could come from your husband. It could come from your wife. It could come from some of your best friends. That here you are desiring to serve God. Come on. And when you start going through some things, instead of them trying to encourage you, what they're really doing is they're trying to beat you up. Because the reality of it is that your desire to live for God has probably brought conviction in their life to begin with. And they've just been waiting for some bad stuff to happen to you so that they can go ahead and beat you up a little bit more. But here's Eliphaz, the Temanite in chapter 4. It says, this is what Eliphaz says, if we essay to commune with thee, wilt thou be grieved? But who can withhold himself from speaking? Now, the word essay, these words here, we have a lot of meaning. You know, the word essay, and we'll talk about it in a second, and the word commune. Basically, the word commune right there, it speaks of community, it speaks of coming together, and it's not, the way we use the word now as a commune would be a collective group of people that live together, but what they're talking about is, can we just have a sit down and have a discussion, Job? I mean, we see all this stuff going on. Who can withhold their peace, Job? Would it be okay if we just came and had a sit down with you, and if we essayed the situation? When you assay something, you can assay metals. What does that mean? It means you test them to prove that they are what they say they are. Quantity-wise, you can put it on a scale, a metal, and you can make sure that it actually weighs what it's supposed to weigh. Quality-wise, there's ways that people can test gold. I know that they got people that go come to your house, have a gold party. Yeah, that's what we do here in America. You want to get, you got all this gold stacked up that you don't wear anymore? Oh boy, have a gold party. Everybody bring their gold over, and what does he do? If you've ever been to one, he has some little chemicals. He scratches some stuff, puts some chemicals on there. Oh, this is some good quality gold right here. I'll give you this for that. And he's assaying the metals, figuring out what's actually in them. And so it's like putting something to the test or proving it. And so what Eliphaz the Temanite is saying is it okay if we come and we have a sit down and we take a look at your situation and we assay it, Job? Is it okay if we start to dig and poke around and we start figuring out what's really going on behind the scenes, what's really going on in the midst of your life? Why in the world all of this stuff has befallen you, Job? Is it okay if we come sit down and we find out what's really happening, or will it bring grief into your life? Is it going to bring grief? Well, of course it's going to bring grief into my life. I'm already grieved. I've already lost just about everything I've lost everything that I've ever had. And you're wanting to know if you're going to bring more grief into my life? Yes, you will. But he goes on to say this, Eliphaz. He says, "Behold, you have instructed many, and you have strengthened the weak hands." So he gives acknowledgement that in all of Job's life, that's what he's done. He's strengthened other people, you know? And he says, "Your words have upholden him that was falling, and you have strengthened the feeble knees. But now it has come upon thee, and thou faintest. It toucheth thee, and thou art troubled." That's a good friend right there. "Is not this thy fear, thy confidence, thy hope, and the uprightness of thy ways? Remember, I pray thee, whoever perished..." No, this is, he's asking a question right here. It's a question mark. "Remember, I pray thee," or the word "pray thee" means "beg thee." I'm begging of you. "Remember this, whoever perished being innocent?" Come on, Job, tell me. So basically he's saying, if you were innocent, you wouldn't be going through this. And I got to tell you something too, before I forget. In each one of the phrases or the discussions that these men have, they have truth within what they're saying. They're just not saying the whole truth. You understand what I'm getting at? And so they actually have some things that have some wisdom, but they're just not telling the whole story. And much of their motives are wrong. Their perception about God is wrong. Their perception about Job in the midst of the circumstance is completely wrong. But nevertheless, every now and then they say some right stuff. And he goes on to say here, I just wanted you to see what the motives of his heart was, the motives of his heart were, and how he was perceiving Job. It says in verse 8 of chapter 5, it says, "I would seek unto God, and unto God would I commit my cause, which doeth great things and unsearchable, marvelous things without number, who gives rain upon the earth and sends water upon the fields." I mean, all that's true. Amen? God does great things. He does unsearchable things. He sends water from heaven upon the earth. And so what Eliphaz is saying, if I were you, Job, this is what I'd do. I would seek unto God. I'm telling you right now, man, you are in a mess, buddy. And the only one that's going to pull you out of this situation is the Lord. So I came to tell you that there's never been an innocent man that perished. And what you need to do is you need to seek unto God. Now, I wanted you to turn real quick to chapter 8. We're going to kind of flip back and forth a little bit. Because this is Bildad. This is another one of Job's friends. He says in verse 2, "How long will you speak?" So he's been listening to Job give his rebuttal to Eliphaz, and then he cuts in at some point. He says, "How long will you speak these things? How long shall the words of your mouth be like a strong wind? Does God pervert judgment, or does the Almighty pervert justice? If thy children have sinned against him, and he have cast them away for their transgression, if thou wouldest seek unto God," betimes, meaning early, if you'd grab a hold of God early, Job, then he says, "and make your supplication to the Almighty. If you were pure and upright, surely now he would awake for you." In other words, you can't find him. He's sleeping. But if you were innocent, if you were pure, God would awaken for you. And it says, "and make the habitation of thy righteousness prosperous." But, you know, one of the things that I wanted you to do, if we'll turn to Job 23 real quick, I wanted to make the point, Job is searching for God. And most times, whenever a believer is going through trials and tribulation, that's what ends up happening, is that it causes them, if they're a true child of God, to seek after the face of God. And Job, as a true child of God, he is seeking God. But these people just think that they know everything that's going on in his life. It says in chapter 23, "Then Job answered and said, 'Even today is my complaint bitter. My stroke is heavier than my groaning. Oh, that I knew where I might find him.'" He's talking about God. "That I might come even to his seat. I would order or arrange my cause before him. I would fill my mouth," the word in the King James is arguments, but the idea is I would come to reason with him. And if I could find the Lord, I'm searching for him, but I can't find him. But if I could find him, I'd come to his seat and I would arrange my understanding of the circumstances the way that I know, and I would try to reason with God. And I would say, "You know, God, I thought that I was serving you the best I knew how." He goes on to say right here, "I would know the words which he would answer me and understand what he was saying to me. Will he plead against me with his great power? No, but he would put strength in me." That's what I know about the God I serve. If I could just find him and get to his seat and bring my cause before him, I know that he wouldn't break me down. You might break me down, Eliphaz. Bildad, you don't have much good to say about old Job right now. But if I could grab a hold of the seat of God, what I know that he would do for me is he would pour strength into me. Because that's the God that I know, and that's the God that I serve. He says right here, "There the righteous might dispute with him, so should I be delivered forever from my judge. Behold, I go forward, but he is not there, and backward, but I cannot perceive him. On the left hand, where he doth work, but I cannot behold him. He hides himself on the right hand, that I cannot see him. But he knows the way that I take." He said, "I can't find him. I don't know the path and the journey that he's on. I've been trying to find him, but right now he seems to be silent. But I know one thing. I know he knows the path that I take. I know that he's watching me in the midst of this journey." And this is what he says. "And when he has tried me, I shall come forth as gold." Now, I got to tell you that in the life of the believer, you need to understand something. There's something that is more precious about you than all the gold that's upon the earth. Turn with me to 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 7. Scripture says right here, let's start at verse 5. "Who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation." You know, I need you to know that word kept, it's interesting, because in the beginning of the Job story, what did Satan say? You put a hedge around it. The hedge literally meaning a fence of protection. The word kept right here in the Greek, it's a word that means a garrison, like an army, that has surrounded and is bringing protection. You are kept. God, the presence of God, has hedged you in with like a garrison army, surrounding you, protecting you with the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. Verse 6. "Wherein you greatly rejoice, though now for a season, if need be, you are in heaviness through manifold temptations," or manifold, many various types of trials. "While you're on this earth, on this side of the eternal veil, you will find yourself in the midst of trial, in the midst of tribulation, manifold meaning all types and diverse situations. You're going to find yourself in the midst of that." Why, Peter? "That the trial of your faith, being much more precious than of gold that perishes, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ." What you and I need to understand is this. Go to Luke chapter 22. That's Peter writing that. While we're turning to Luke chapter 22, I want to tell you something. I want to tell you this. I want to tell you that whenever Jesus came upon the earth and he proclaimed that he was the Son of Man, that guess what? He went into the wilderness, led by the Holy Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by Satan. Satan's like, "Oh, you're the King of the Jews. Oh, you're the only begotten of the Father. Well, then go ahead, let's see how you handle this." And when he went through the trial and the temptation of Satan, and he came out victorious on the other side. You and I have been born again of Christ. Amen. You and I have placed our faith in him. We've died in him. We've been buried in him. And we've been resurrected to newness of life. And the Holy Spirit, the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead, now quickens our mortal body. Hallelujah. And how dare you say out of your mouth, you belong to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And you think that you're not going to be tested. You think that your faith isn't going to be put to the fire. No, I got good news for you, Christian. It's going to be. But hallelujah. You rejoice in the day when you're persecuted, or rejoice in the day that you find yourself in various trials, because the trying of your faith, hallelujah, it brings hope, it brings character in your life, it teaches perseverance and how to hold on. That's Romans 5. How to hold on in the faith, amen. And so I want you to see, though, in Luke chapter 22, it says right here, if I can even find the scripture, I meant to mark it. 31. Luke 22:31. This is what the Lord said to Simon Peter. He said, Simon, Simon, behold, Satan has desired to have you, that he may sift you as wheat. But I have prayed for thee, that your faith fail not, and when you are converted, strengthen your brethren. I wanted you to see this, that I wanted you to see that Peter, when he writes in his letter about the trying of your faith, and that it's much more precious than gold. I want you to understand that Peter, like Job, had some experience in this. That Satan himself had gone and asked permission to put Peter to the test. Satan has asked permission, Simon, to sift you like wheat. He wants to separate you. That's a sifting of wheat. It's going to separate your husk from grain. It's going to grind the flour down. He wants to separate you from the fold. He wants to cause you to be destroyed in the faith. But don't, he said, Jesus said, but my prayer for you, not that you would be plucked out of the trial before the time, not that you'd be removed from the fire, no, but that your faith fail not. And when you're converted, doesn't mean to be saved again. It means to get back on the right path. When you come back on the right path, strengthen your brethren. Sometimes you and I got to go through some things in life to come to the realization, once again, I preach it a lot, that it ain't all about us. And that God desires to fill us up with his presence so that he can pour himself out of us and other people. Amen? But if we're so busy, worried about our own self and how we're going to accomplish things for our own self, then the reality of it is that we never come to that place of realization that God desires to use us. Amen? And so listen, Peter and Job, they got something in common. Let's go back to Job chapter 8. They've been through a trial. And the enemy wants to destroy them, and he wants to destroy you, and he wants to cause us to get our eyes off of the Lord. So I wanted you to see that. I wanted you to see that that Job was seeking for God, and that's what they were saying. You know that he wasn't even looking for the Lord. Amen. All right. Let's see. Oh, let's go back a little bit to chapter 4. Where he said all that about who gives rain upon the earth and sends waters upon the fields. This is what he said. This is Eliphaz still talking right here since chapter 4. He's saying this about God. This is what God does. He disappoints the devices of the crafty so that their hands cannot perform their enterprise. So he's saying, you know, Job, this is the thing. This is what's going on here. You're crafty. You're not really an honorable man like you've been portraying that you were. And in reality, what's happened is that God has touched you in this situation because he doesn't allow the crafty in heart to prosper. And so what he's done is he's destroyed your prosperity. And you know, my thing to that is, well, sometimes God does that. But that ain't the reality of the world that we live in. And if you turn to chapter 21, Job brings it out a little bit later. He says in chapter 21, when he's answering somebody else, and then we'll just start reading. It says, but Job answered and said, hear diligently my speech and let this be your consolation. Suffer me that I may speak, and after that I have spoken, mock on. As for me is my complaint to man, and if it were so, why should not my spirit be troubled? Mark me and be astonished, and lay your hand upon your mouth. In other words, he's a sight to see. I mean, it's hard for us to see it, but I mean, he's messed up. And they're just like, oh, they're all shock and awe. Oh my gosh, look at Job. He looks so horrible. He's lost everything. He's so, oh my gosh, he's been stricken with boils. The evil. Now we realize what he really was. Go ahead, put your hand over your mouth and mock me, is what he's saying. And he says, wherefore do the wicked live, verse 7, become old, yea, are mighty in power. Their seed is established in their sight with them, their offspring before their eyes. Their houses are safe from fear, neither is the rod of God upon them. Their bull gendereth, in other words, their bull is making babies and fails not. Their cow has babies and casteth not her calf. In other words, she's not having abortions. They're having plenty of cattle that's multiplying. They send forth their little ones like a flock, and their children dance. Look at this. They take the timbrel and harp, musical instruments, and rejoice at the sound of the organ. They spend their days in wealth, and in a moment go down to the grave. Therefore they say unto God, depart from us, for we desire not the knowledge of thy ways. What is the Almighty that we should serve him, and what profit should we have if we pray unto him? So Job's saying later on, the reality of it is, buddy, is this, is that no, if you really take a look around and you look at some of the people that are living a wicked life around here, they're some of the most prosperous people that you would ever want to see. They'll step on people. They don't care about the things of God. They're having music. They're having feasts. And they're saying, hey, let's live for today. And the reality of it is that they say, we don't want God in the midst of our circumstances. And so what I'm just trying to make a point to you is that some of these people are saying some things that have half-truths, and they're trying to turn things around on Job, but the reality of it is that they're not speaking whole truths. And see, true wisdom has to be able to discern the whole situation. Yes, does God prosper? Absolutely. Does God bless? Absolutely. But you're not promised financial blessings. Let me tell you something. Financial blessings, God is behind it for his children, but financial blessings come to those that are willing to put their hand to the plow and work. Yeah. Listen, I can tell you right now that when you see somebody that's financially stable, it's because they not only put their hand to the plow, but more than likely they saved what they earned. Come on, somebody. Yeah. They didn't spend their... And listen to me. I'll preach it to the preacher, because I have not handled my money the way that I should have. I thank God that it's gotten somewhat better. But the fact of the matter is this. You can make all the money in the world you want to, but if you don't handle your finances properly, you're still going to end up at the end of the day without anything. Amen. So don't think that, you know, God will bless the hands of his people, but it's always been God's will that man would work. He put Adam in the garden before the fall to tend and to keep. Amen. So I'm just trying to say that you know, God does bless, but at the same time, the wicked prosper. Because many times they know how to work with unrighteous mammon, like Jesus said. And they know how to handle the things of the world system. And they're shrewd in their business dealings. And listen, this world, the prince of this world is Satan himself. And if people that don't handle their business right, many times in this world system, they do. They prosper. And they gain financially. All right. So I wanted you to see that part there. This is just kind of somewhat Job's heart here in chapter 9. Job answered and said in verse 1 of chapter 9. Job answered and said, I know it is so of a truth, but how should man be just with God? If he will contend with him, he cannot answer him, one of a thousand. He is wise in heart and mighty in strength, who has hardened himself against him and has prospered. In other words, who's going to contend with the Almighty? Job goes back and forth, and there's some times that he's not real happy about his situation. But when he comes back to his senses, he's like, what am I going to do? I mean, the reality of it is, if I could find his seat, what I would do is I would try to plead my cause before him. But the fact of the matter is, who's going to contend with God and prosper? How are you going to go against him? How are you going to go against the Almighty and think that you're going to win? It's not going to happen. The Apostle Paul found that out whenever God knocked him down on the road to Damascus. He said, Saul, Saul, why do you kick against the pricks or the goads? Who are you, Lord? I'm Jesus, the one whom you persecute. It was like, you know what a goad is? I've told you all that before. It's like a pointed stick that you poke an animal in his hindquarters to get it moving in the right direction. And Paul's over there kicking against it. And many of us, the same thing, kicking against the pricks, kicking against the way that God's trying to move us in the right direction, refusing to go the way of God. And so here we see the situation. You're not going to win. You can keep on fighting. Come on. You can keep on fighting. You can keep on contending with the Almighty, but you will not prosper if you continue to do that. He's trying to get us all to submit.
Yes,
let me tell you, some of us are more stiff-necked than others. Lord knows I'm stubborn. And you know, but he's patient. He's been doing this a long time. And he's gonna be, and it doesn't mean he don't love you. As a matter of fact, the Word of God says in Hebrews, God chastens those whom he loves.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I'm just telling you what the Word of God says. The old King James, you're not a bastard. A bastard is a child that doesn't have a father. And he said, he chastens those whom he loves. He scourges everyone who's his son. But if he doesn't discipline you, then you're fatherless. And if you find yourself in the midst of the trial, that God is trying to scourge you, chasing you, and to bring you to the place, amen, that he desires for you to be. Here's Job in chapter 10. It says, my soul is weary of my life. I will leave my complaint upon myself. I will speak in the bitterness of my soul. I will say unto God, do not condemn me. Show me wherefore thou contendest with me. Is it good unto thee that thou shouldest oppress, that thou shouldest despise the work of thine hands and shine upon the counsel of the wicked? He's saying, God, you formed me. You formed me with your own hands. I'm pleading with you. Would you show me where I went wrong? Would you show me where I went wrong so that I can make things right? Does it please you? Who is the work of your hand to bring destruction upon me? Won't you show me? You hear the cry of his heart. The reality of it is that the motives of Job's heart throughout this trial, he's not casting blame on God. He's come to the realization he's humble enough, even with all the wealth that he had and all of the things that he had, to realize, listen, if God allows this to happen in my life, he's still God and I'm still a man. And all I can know to do is to humble myself and to cry out to him and say, God, won't you have your way with me? Amen? And it says right here in verse 11, chapter 11, I'm sorry. This is another one, Zophar, the Naamathite. Should not the multitude of words be answered, and should not a man full of talk be justified? Should thy lies make men hold their peace? And when thou mockest, shall no man make thee ashamed? For thou hast said, my doctrine is pure, and I am clean in thine eyes. But oh, that God would speak and open his lips against thee. Oh, he's going to speak, all right, Zophar. Don't worry, just hold on just a little bit. We're getting close to the end. He's about to start speaking. And when God starts speaking, people's eyes are going to be open and realize that you know, it's not exactly what you thought it was. Amen? All right, so let's see here. Let's turn to chapter 16. See, now we see the heart. We're going to get a glimpse of the heart of Job. We've seen the heart of his so-called friends and how they're full of self-righteousness and really not there to comfort him at all, but instead they're wanting to pick him apart in the midst of his misery. Well, here's Job's heart right here. And man, I'm telling you, man, this is the heart of Jesus. What Job speaks right here, this is the heart of the Lord. Amen? It says, then Job answered and said, I have heard many such things. Miserable comforters are you all. Shall vain words have an end? Or what emboldeneth thee that thou answerest? I also could speak as you do. I could do the same thing. If your soul were in my soul's stead or in my place, I could heap up words against you and shake my head at you. Can you see them over there? They got their hand over their mouth and they're just like, oh, poor Job, man. He's really a mess. But look what he says. But I would strengthen you with my mouth, and the moving of my lips would assuage your grief. In other words, I wouldn't do what you're doing. If you were in my situation, what I would do is I would strengthen you with words of encouragement. I would speak to you, amen, the words of God. And you know, I think that we can all learn something from that.
Yes.
Because I know that there's things in our hearts, and I'm talking for all of us. There's things in our hearts that whenever calamity strikes people, sometimes I think we need to stop and we need to hear how we're talking about it. You understand what I'm getting at? When I say calamity, maybe not something quite this bad, but just something bad happens. Oh, you heard what happened to so-and-so, huh? Mm-hmm. He got caught again. Yep. Robert found his picture again. Robert's scrolling through the arrest report. Robert found his picture again. Or her picture again. And it done happened. And you know, the reality of it is that what do? We start, in our minds, we start formulating, yeah, well, man, they get their heart right. They get their heart right with God, you know? And you can't say that we haven't all fought it, you know, because you know good and well we have. And the reality of it is that we got our own issues. And should our little picture, sometimes we can hide our stuff, but should our little picture get up on the screen, Lord, you better be ready because people are going to be doing the same for you. But you know, the heart of Job, Lord, you know, I think the Lord's preaching to me right now. The heart of Job is that I want to strengthen you.
Yes.
Whenever you find yourself in the midst of this circumstance, I want to bring strength to you. Amen. That's what the Lord would do, man. When the Lord does a work on the inside of your heart, he changes things. He changes your mindset about things, right? I mean, true Christianity is going to sound and look different. Does that make sense?
Yes.
It's an inside job.
Amen.
Listen, how many times have you ever been to a church that's full of religious folk?
Yep.
I mean, I'm just asking you a question. Yeah. A church full of religious folk. And all they do is judge everybody.
Yep.
All they do is look down their self-righteous nose and judge everybody. Listen to me. I mean, goodness gracious, if you ain't living just like them, then you ain't sanctified. But the problem is that self-righteousness is one of the worst sins. That's the one that put Jesus on the cross. The Pharisees couldn't even see their own sin. And that's where most of these religious-minded people are. They're full of self-righteousness, and they can't even see their... But they sure are willing to talk about everybody else.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
And have a party when they, you know, on the back say, oh, man, did you hear about this? When in reality, what we ought to do is we ought to be praying.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Let's start trying to practice that.
Yes.
I mean, you...
That we know better than them.
Amen. Right. Praise God. And I'm going to tell you something. You talk about start making some uncomfortable situations whenever you're at work or whatever, and somebody starts saying, and it's a friend of yours that you go to church with, and you start talking about, hey, man, let's pray for him. You know what I'm saying? It'll disarm the situation.
Yes.
That's
really
what we ought to be doing.
Yes.
We ought to be praying for people. Amen? All right. You know, in chapter 19, Job is under the impression, for sure, that it was God that did this. He can't see in the spiritual realm, and he's under the impression that God has touched him. It says right here in chapter 19, starting in verse 1, then Job answered and said, how long will you vex my soul and break me in pieces with words? He's talking to these men. These 10 times have you reproached me. You are not ashamed that you make yourself strange to me. And be it indeed that I have erred, my error remaineth with myself. Okay, so you got it right. I've erred. I made it. I've done something that I wasn't supposed to do. How long is this going to go on? If indeed you will magnify yourselves against me and plead against my reproach, know now that God has overthrown me and has compassed me with his net. Behold, I cry out of wrong, but I am not heard. I cry aloud, but there is no judgment. You hear the cry of his heart. I don't know what else to do. I've been crying out to God. Yeah, okay, you're right. I'm wrong. I've done something wrong. I've displeased God. All this has befallen upon me. And I realize that, but I just don't know what it is. I asked the Lord to show me. I can't find him. I can't find a seat. I can't get to him. But here you are. You keep on heaping up these words. He has fenced up my way. That, remember in the beginning, the enemy said you built a hedge around him. The same word, but used as fence. He's fenced it. So what the enemy was talking about, protection, Job now saying he's locked me in. Job's looking at it like the other way. He's locked me in. I can't go anywhere. And now all this misery is coming upon me. He stripped me of my glory, verse 9, and taken the crown from my head. He's destroyed me on every side, and I am gone, and my hope has he removed like a tree. He has also kindled his wrath against me, And I am gone, and my hope hath he removed like a tree. Verse 12, his troops come together and raise up their way against me and encamp round about my tabernacle. He has put my brethren far from me, and mine acquaintance are verily estranged from me. My kinfolk have failed, and my familiar friends have forgotten me. They that dwell in my house and my maids count me for a stranger. I'm an alien in their sight. I called my servant, and he gave me no answer. I entreated him with my mouth. My breath is strange to my wife. He goes on, and he's talking about the way that he feels. You know, I'm going to be honest with you. I listened to the book of Job probably four times this week, and I just sit there with tears just rolling down my eyes as I was driving. I mean, the presence of God was just so thick in my choir, I couldn't even really retain. I mean, even I was listening to, but I could just feel the presence of God in the midst of all this, of all that Job was going through, thinking about the people of God, amen, and the things that we go through as the children of God, and the war that we're in the midst of. And I'm telling you, it's like, you know, the presence of God is just on this. I mean, if you can, you should be able to feel it. And if you can't feel it now, believe me, whenever you go through the trial, remember that Job went through the trial. Amen. We're about to close. And what we're going to close with, let's see, I'm going to get there. Just give me a second. I think we're going to be turning really almost completely to the end here. Chapter 42. Well, you know, in verse, I mean, you can hold your place in 42, and I'm just going to let you know that in chapter 40, you know, even going back maybe a little bit further than that, yeah, chapter 38, I always liked this verse when I used to read it. In chapter 38, verse 1, then the Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind and said, so God put me in silence. And out of the whirlwind of what Job was in the midst of, God begins to answer him. And he says, who is this that darkens counsel by words without knowledge? Gird up now your loins like a man, for I will demand of thee and answer thou me. So he's talking to Job now. So we can see already in Job's life that everything wasn't exactly the way that God wanted it to be in Job's life. Some of the things that Job was saying, you know, God was maybe taking some issue with it. But once again, when it's all said and done, you're going to see whose heart was right before the Lord. And so he tells him things like, you know, where were you? I always love this chapter, but let's just read a little bit of it. He says in verse 4, gird up your loins. He said, I'm going to ask you some questions and you give me some answers, Job. Where were you when I laid the foundations of the earth? Declare if you have understanding. Who has laid the measures thereof? If you know, or who has stretched the line upon it? In other words, do you know how big this earth is? Whereupon are the foundations thereof fastened? Or who laid the cornerstone thereof? When the morning stars sang, talking about angels, together, and all the sons of God shouted for joy, or who shut up the sea with doors, and it brake forth as if it had issued out of the womb? When I made the cloud the garment thereof, and thick darkness a swaddling band for it? And I just wanted you to see some of the terminology that God, when he answers Job out of the whirlwind, he's saying, you need to gird yourself up, and I'm going to ask you some questions like a man, and I want you to give me some answers. I'm God, and I really feel like when we see some of what Job was saying, that Job had a revelation of that, but God wanted to make it even more clear to him. And God, I believe in all of this, not I believe, I know, wanted to make himself more clear to Job. And that's one of the other things that you and I need to come to the realization. When you find yourself in a trial or tribulation, that's why Paul talked about counting it all joy in Romans 5. James talked about it too. Because when the trial is over, you know God in a way now that you never knew him.
Amen.
Amen. Because you begin to seek him and you learn some things about him. And let me tell you this. What we're about to see right here in chapter 42. Let's just go ahead and turn here so we can close this up. In chapter 42, what you're going to see is not only do you begin to learn God more, you begin to learn more about yourself.
Amen.
In the midst of a trial, you begin to learn more about yourself. It says in chapter 42, verse 1, then Job answered the Lord and said, I know that you can do everything, and that no thought can be withholden from thee. Who is he that hideth counsel without knowledge? Therefore have I uttered that I understood not, things too wonderful for me, which I knew not. In other words, Job's admitting, I said some things in the midst of all this And, you know, I thought that I had some wisdom, and there were some areas where I wasn't exactly right. And verse 4, "Here I beseech thee," Job saying, "here I beg thee, and I will speak. I will demand of thee, and declare thou unto me." In other words, I'm asking you, God, to speak unto me and show me the error of my ways. All right? He says, "I have heard of thee by the hearing of the ear, but now mine eye has seen thee." You know, in other words, as much as Job knew God before, when he had all of the stuff that he had, and he was the most wealthy man on the earth, and he had all of the wisdom, you know, what he's admitting now is this, is that I thought I knew you before. But now what I realize is that the way I knew you before was I had just heard about you. But now my eyes have seen you. In the midst of all of this, and the way that all this has gone down, I have gotten a more clear picture of you now than I ever did before. Listen to me. When you fail God, you will find the forgiveness of God in a way like you never did before. Whenever you've been through trial, you will find the delivering power of God in a way like you never did before. All I can tell you is that you got to hold on to it in the midst of it all. Hallelujah for him to be able to deliver you out of it. And he says right here in verse 6, well, let's go back to 5 and get the whole thought. "I have heard of thee by the hearing of the ear, but now my eye has seen thee. Wherefore I abhor myself and repent in dust and ashes." So what Job has come to the realization is this. Now that I see myself, I repent. I cry out to you, and I realize that I wasn't all right in the midst of this situation. If you remember Isaiah chapter 6, in the year King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord seated on the throne. The train of his robe filled the temple with glory. The seraphim cried, "Holy, holy, holy." The doorposts of the temple began to shake. And then Isaiah the prophet said, "Woe unto me, for I'm a man of unclean lips, and I live amongst the people of unclean lips." When you truly begin to see God and truly begin to get into his presence, you'll know it because your heart becomes broken. Because you can see yourself for who you really are. Now this is the part that I'm going to close with, and I just love this. So after Job says all this, then God comes back in verse 7. He says, "It was so after that the Lord had spoken these words unto Job, the Lord said to Eliphaz the Temanite, my wrath is kindled against thee and against your two friends, for you have not spoken of me the thing that is right, as my servant Job has. Therefore, take unto you now 7 bullocks and 7 rams," this is the number of fulfillment and completion, "and go to my servant Job and offer up for yourselves a burnt offering, and my servant Job shall pray for you, for him will I accept, lest I deal with you after your folly, and that you have not spoken of me the thing which is right, like my servant Job." In other words, God's not even having a relationship with these boys. He's like, "Y'all need to bring a sacrifice for the payment of y'all's sin, but you need to ask Job to pray for you. Because if Job won't pray for you, I'm about to let my anger be kindled against you." And one of the things that should show us, I think, is this, is that we need to be careful. Amen? We need to be careful whenever people are going through trial and tribulation in their life, that we're not taking joy in it. I mean, there's something about our human nature that likes talking about other people's mess. And I'm just being honest. When I get it, that's one of the big things I get out of this story. The Lord don't want us dealing with that. Amen? God's about healing people, strengthening people, speaking hope into their lives.